All right. Hello, Fortina's brothers and sisters. Welcome back to Ministry Revealed. It is May 24th, 2024. Oh, man, we are going to have some exciting times tonight. We are going to spend the bulk of our time in a variety of places in the book of Daniel. In fact, we're going to touch briefly on chapter 2 and 3 and then focus on 4. 5, 6, 7, 8, a little touch on 9, a little touch in 10. We are going to really, really get into these understandings that are revealed in the book of Daniel. We're going to show how they overlap, how they tie in. It has so much in it. But, you know, it's something. I had a great conversation at a Zoom chat with our brother Jake yesterday. He's a fellow Canadian, and he found us about two and a half years ago through his father, who is down in Paraguay. And I thought that was awesome. And he says they've been studying all of the videos here in Ministry Revealed. They study them together after they come out. It was so exciting. It was such a blessing to hear. And in the conversation with him, we were discussing on these things, because a lot of our talks and emails back and forth in relation to our emails, this was our first time talking. And it was almost 4 hours last night. So it was an awesome talk. Great getting to know. And a lot of it was on the conversation about Babylon. And, you know, trying to understand this portion with Babylon a little bit more. We're not really going to be, I mean, Babylon is part of the conversation today. But it's more so the kings of Babylon. Who are those over Babylon, and how it relates to the period of the time of the end? And what you're going to notice is something we've shared on a number of times. And I'll bring this up real quick. You guys will remember, we know that there's a 70 that ends it, or right, a 70 ends and then things begin. And then there's a 70 that ends and it's the final judgment, like the days of Noah, that final year. And it's really, you're going to really see it come into play as we get into this tonight, because we know there's a period of the end of the Nebuchadnezzar type, yet there's the conversation of like the beginning of 70 and the events that will take place. And yet at the end of it all, when we know 70 ends, the king of Babylon destroyed and Babylon destroyed. And it's like the end of this other 70. And so you'll kind of see, I mean, if you've been following for a while, this isn't going to be, I mean, I say this every once in a while, it's not going to be for the faint of heart. And, you know, if you watch this last video, oh man, it was, for me, you know, as bringing about the revelation, for me, this was a wow teaching. And, but it wasn't for the faint of heart. And that one especially wasn't for the faint of heart. You really had to have been around in the ministry and understanding and tracking the revelations that have been coming over the last, you know, at least 2-3 years, or have really, really been focusing and spending time over the last several months diligently seeking these things, because it was wild. It was so exciting. And tonight is a little bit more of that type of thing. Not all of the same context of everything, but in trying to understand that when it comes to prophecy, okay, this is something we've shared on many times over the years. When it comes to prophecy, you have to keep this in mind with Ecclesiastes 1:9. The thing that has been is the thing which shall be. That which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun, which means what? The thing that has been done will be. So from the beginning of creation until Christ is has been, is the was. From Christ until the moment of the pre-trib is the is. And the is to come is from the moment of the pre-trib until the end. And it tells us that the things that was from creation to Christ are the things that are going to be revealing to us in the is to come. And the things that are done, the things that are in the is since Christ until the moment of the pre-trib, are also things within it that are things that shall be done. And so what this is telling you is that there is a clear mystery. Clear mystery, right? It's clearly saying that there is prophetic things to understand from the was and from the is, but you can't just look at these things and read them as they are on the page. You have to be able to read through them, see through them, and understand them. And this is something that had been a mystery hidden since the beginning of creation, revealed, as the Lord had said, for the time of the end. There's no getting around it. We can show that it's a fact that these things are happening. And when you see this tonight, you're going to see these types of things where this, there's a typology where it's like the beginning of 70, yet we see another portion where it's the end of 70. And it just so happens that we know in the time of the end, we have the prophetic 70 years coming to an end this year based on scripture. And we've got a 70 coming to an end for Jerusalem from 1967 at the end of 13 years when the Lord returns then feet down on the Mount of Olives to complete the 14th year. So you really have to be able to track these things, right? You have to be able to see where these typologies are, how they explain each other. Like seeing in a piece of scripture, for example, where a conversation for which we'll get into about like Nebuchadnezzar, and it talks about his 70 years, and then it talks about Cyrus. Well, in between Cyrus, there was another king. It was another king of Babylon. And then another thing that we forget. So sorry, before I jump ahead, in that, why isn't the other one discussed? Because it's when the 70 are over and the time when the end of days Cyrus shows up, the prophetic type Cyrus will show up. But is he the only one at that time? Well, what about that other king? The only way to really solve that and to understand it is to really diligently seek the scriptures. And because of what we understand of how things begin, we can see based on the years discussed by some of these kings. You'll see what I mean as we really get going into it, that this is stuff that is just in the last couple days of studying that have really just started to jump out at me, and we're able to show this prophetic picture even more clearly. You'll see what I mean when I get into it. But when it comes to prophecy and Ecclesiastes, we have to understand that the typologies are not easy. That's why these things have been hidden till the time of the end. It's not easy to see through the scriptures and get into their definitions and understand where they tie together. And in fact, it's impossible if somebody's trying to do it without understanding the gospels in the end of days and without understanding that the true end of days is 14 years. It is impossible to actually do. That's why it's been so confusing since it was written, because it was to be revealed in the time of the end. So we'll get into it. I'm not going to try to lay out too much into it. You'll be able to track it as we continue to go forward. So the other thing I want to say is I'll have another video, because our brother Jake had shared something with me by email afterwards as well in regards to the book of Zephaniah. And the book of Zephaniah, 3 chapters. Yeah, you can already guess what it's about in a sense. I had looked at it in the past more than once and found key pieces, but it just wasn't clicking. This time, I went through and I looked at the titles today, and bam, there it was. The whole thing laid out. It's like a pre, mid, and post, but not in the sense that you might think, because its focus is Judah. Its focus is Judah. So that'll be an upcoming video, just giving you a little heads up on that one. And now for anybody that's new here in the ministry, you're coming across a video like this, you could start with this video if you've got a pretty good grasp of scripture. But what we always do and what we always recommend is come to this playlist right here on YouTube, or you can go right here to ministryrevealed.com and go to the intro page. And on the intro page, you'll see the list of videos, and the first 4 videos are the same as the first 4 videos in order here. That list of videos is a 22-minute introduction video with this image on it, which will lay out what you're about to begin to understand in the next three videos that follow. The second video is a 30-minute intro into what we've revealed called the differences in the Gospels, or who the Gospels are speaking to. This becomes vitally, vitally important. It was the beginning of the revelation here in Ministry Revealed. And why it was so important is because we've got the synoptic Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Why didn't God just put everything in the Gospel of Matthew and be done with it, since everybody is always being taught 90%, 95% of the time when it comes to Gospels, they're being taught from the Gospel of Matthew? Why didn't he just put it all in there and forget Mark and Luke? The answer is prophecy. You'll notice that there are differences in the Gospels, and pastors will try to tell you that it was just perspective. And in some cases, you could say it was perspective in the is from when Christ was here. But in the is to come, you will see that it is all about prophecy. And in fact, many of the things that they try to tell us are just perspective cannot be reconciled by just saying, oh, it was this person's perspective compared to the others. And a great example that I always use is in Luke's gospel. You see, Christ, before going to the cross, was arrayed in a gorgeous robe. The definition means white, radiant, beautiful. In Mark, he was arrayed in purple, and in Matthew, he was arrayed in scarlet. Wasn't that interesting? A beautiful, white, gorgeous robe, which is like a bride, and purple and scarlet are tribulation colors, like the woman riding the beast in Revelation 17. So there's all of these little intricate details, and they are all prophecy. We have discovered and spoken and taught on dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of them. And they always reveal the same thing. You will come to see that pre, mid, and post are all true. And there's a reason why everybody can defend their position within Scripture, because they are all true. Matthew, Mark, Luke, in the end of days is Luke, Mark, Matthew. The last will be first, the first will be last. That is the revelation of it. And you will see these in, you'll begin to understand more of it within that 30-minute second video, which is a Bible study of the differences in the Gospels, but just an introduction. The third video is a 30-minute intro of the 14 years. Once you begin to understand the differences in the Gospels and see that Luke, Mark, and Matthew are speaking to three groups prophetically: the bride of Christ, the remnant church, the church that's going to go through seals, that wasn't prepared as a spotless bride ready and watching, but will remain during seals for the, and then be part of the great multitude rapture in the seventh year of seals. And then you've got Matthew, when the Lord returns for all eyes to see, feet down on the Mount of Olives, lightning from one end to the other, at the seventh year of trumpets, which is the beginning of the 14th year. It will blow your mind. And that third video is just an introduction to begin to help you understand it. Pre, mid, or in post are all true. It's a taking, and a return. The first taking goes to the third heaven. The second taking goes to paradise. And the third is the Lord returning feet down for the city. And then, of course, the millennial reign. The fourth video that you'll see in this is the big one. It's about 2 hours and 45 minutes. And I promise you, all of these are going to be worth your time. If you have ever had a desire to really better understand prophecy, you've been led to the right place. And in that fourth video, you're going to understand why these things had been missed. I used to think that it was because, you know, way back behind the curtain in the churches, it's hidden. I don't so much believe that now, because we can show that it was mysteries revealed for the time of the end. It hadn't been understood. And what I mean by that is the Gospel of Matthew. That video is called It's All Because of Matthew. And the reason for it is because the synoptic Gospels of Mark and Luke hadn't been understood in their purpose. So everybody, churches, all of the pastors, seminaries, scholars, everybody had their focus over the last 2,000 years in the Gospel, especially in the last 500, in the Gospel of Matthew. And they would only look to Luke and to Mark for other little tidbits, not realizing what their portion was. And so everybody's focus everybody's foundational gospel understanding, unbeknownst to them, comes from Matthew. And why I say unbeknownst is because they don't realize why they don't know Mark and Luke like they should. So everybody's focus is Matthew. And when your focus is Matthew and you don't know who Mark and Luke are speaking to, guess what you end up seeing? You end up only seeing 7,000 years total, and you end up only seeing 7 years of tribulation. As you have completed and you go through these videos and you decide to scroll further through, I would even recommend going to the website, going to the intro page there, and after you watch those four and you study them out and you pray over it, and you then follow through, go into some of those deeper level videos where much more is revealed. And by the time you get to the last one on the intro page, man, it's all about what's called, it's a fractal. It goes all the way back to the beginning of creation. It will blow your mind. But the revelation of it all began with the differences in the Gospels and who they're speaking to. It's prophecy that brings clarity to was, is, and reveals the is to come. God is good. It's extremely exciting. So, with that, I'd also like to give a shout out and say thanks. You know, every once in a while, I want to give thanks to our brothers and sisters that help out in the ministry. We have our brother we call Uncle Jimmy, who takes care of our Facebook posts and so forth. We have our sister Trisha, who takes care of our Twitter posts. And of course, we have our brother Jimmy, who takes care of the Ministry Revealed website, which is a very important thing, as you can imagine. We have hundreds of videos in there. We have all sorts of things being posted in there, and links to all these things so more people can study it, more people can research. And so I want to give a shout out and a thanks to everybody. And also, within the links right here, if you click on the link, if you wanted to support the ministry, there's our mailing address, but we also have PayPal. And the reason I'm bringing it up now is our brother Jimmy is in need of a new laptop so that he can do the work. And we're just a small ministry. We support a ministry with our brother Steve in Uganda that is incredibly reaching tens of thousands of people now. And so we're not flush with cash or anything. So when somebody is in need, we do what we can to raise some funds. And we did it a little bit in the forum, but I don't think he got all the support that he needed yet. So if you wanted to, you can support Ministry Revealed. You can put, as you send it, if you send through PayPal, you can just put Jimmy there. If you want to support our ministry in Uganda, you can just put Steve in a comment. If you don't put anything, I'll allocate it as it's needed to Jimmy and to Steve and so forth. So with that, thank you all so very much. We're always grateful. We appreciate it. We appreciate the prayers for those who are unable to support. The prayers always come first. I don't say that jokingly. I don't say that tongue in cheek. I absolutely mean it. Prayers come first. And if you're interested in joining prayers or being part of the community, when you go to ministryrevealed.com and go to the menu, you can click on what's called the forum. You can click on there. There's over 1,200 people in there worldwide, and it's like-minded brothers and sisters diligently seeking and searching, watching and praying for the Lord, lifting each other up, doing Bible studies, putting up prayer requests to pray for each other, for family members, news and events, all sorts of things with brothers and sisters all over the world. It takes a few seconds to join, and it's absolutely free. All right. So now with that, let's get this started. Oh man, you know what? I have to bring this up first. I don't know if in the last video, in the last teaching, I don't know how many people, well, I generally do know, by the way. I don't know who the people are, but I know how many people actually watch the full video. And it's generally about 25% of all views. So I know that, you know, out of 2,100, only about 500 and change actually watch to the end. And the reason I'm saying that is because towards the end of that video, when we went through Gabriel's revelation, oh man, these things that we have talked about, that we have shared, these things that we have understood, not because we had Gabriel's revelation, not because we knew the ancient writings of rabbis and the prophetic interpretations of Messiah ben Joseph, but because we were able to discern and reveal these things by the leading of the Holy Ghost through the revelation of Scripture. We know who this Messiah Ephraim figure is Christ at the end of seals. We know he's going to destroy the beast, the Antichrist evil one at the end of seals. We know at the end of seals, he's going to be gone and he won't return until mid trumpets. And here it says when Ephraim breaks that evil, right? He destroys him. And then what happens later? The text talks about the prince who is the leader of Israel, which is Christ, which I showed we have it in our book, and who is killed by the evil king. So the evil king is broken and he's gone, right? He was, then he is not. Because Israel's leader is there, who's Messiah ben Ephraim or Messiah ben Joseph, high priest and king. And then he's what? He's going to be killed by the evil king, because at mid trumpets, the beast that was and then was not shall be when he comes out of the pit. And then he's not properly buried. And then suddenly the evil king is miraculously defeated, because when the Lord returns feet down, then the beast and the false prophet are cast alive into the lake of fire. This is something that was written on what's called Gabriel's revelation on stone tablets with ink that I think are over 2,200 years old or something like that. So absolutely incredible. And I just wanted to touch on that again, because it's not because we didn't already know it. It's that we have yet another piece of confirming revelation, and this one is believed to have been from Gabriel. Like, come on. So awesome. So awesome. So you'll remember, again, the reason I wanted to share this real briefly too is when I was talking about Ecclesiastes. So in Ecclesiastes, you know, the was, so you got the Old Testament typology of the seven churches, right? Of course there weren't seven churches in the Old Testament, but you have the typology of periods of time, of events that took place over about 2,500 years. In the is, you have the events from Christ until the time that we're in now, until the moment of the pre-trib, and this is played out over about 2,000 years. The end of days, seven churches, which we have revealed, and it's in the book here, which if you want, you can either get it on Amazon, or you can just download it for free from ministryrevealed.com. Or you can even listen to it for free on ministryrevealed.com. And I think we have it translated in five languages. So the end of days, seven churches, we know is the 50 days and 14 years. That's how the seven churches will replay again. It took about 2,500 years in typology. It took about 2,000 years. And in the end of days, it's 50 days and 14 years. Why do I bring it up? Because of this conversation that we're having. Because what we know is that in the end of days, this typology of things that are playing out is overlapping and twisting, and it's weaved in between everything. And so even though it might look like, well, this guy is done in his portion with this king and then this one shows up, it's never generally that cut and dry, because they are interwoven with events that have taken place that are giving us prophetic insight in the same types of events that will play out in the is to come. And we're doing it with things that have been, which are, that shall be. So it's this intricately detailed woven layer under the scriptures and within the scriptures, generally really clearly revealed within definitions, that brings it all to light. And so you're going to see as we get going into this what it is exactly I'm talking about, and you'll see how the clarity gets more clear. All right, so one of the key pieces, of course, we all know this one. I had a good picture, didn't really want that picture, there we go. Okay, one of the ones that we all understand, and you'll understand why I'm sharing with this one first. Of course, this is from Daniel chapter 2. So let's go to Daniel chapter 2 and briefly go through this. We know, you know, he reveals deep and secret things, the God in heaven. And here's what it says. So starting in Daniel 2 verse 28, but there is a God in heaven that revealeth secrets and maketh it known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days. You see, right off the bat, people would say, well, that's just the latter days of Nebuchadnezzar back in his day. Well, sure it was. But remember, everything is there for prophetic insight and layers within it. And so we know right off the bat, in the latter days. So is Nebuchadnezzar going to be here? No. But is there a Nebuchadnezzar type maybe here? Yeah, definitely. And it relates to this Babylon, you know, being this king or this ruler over Babylon. And like I said, we're not going to go too far into what Babylon is or where Babylon specifically is, because man, that's still a head scratcher in many cases. Yeah, it could be somewhere in America. It could be somewhere in the Middle East. Some people think it's Rome. Okay. And there's insights and parts that really makes you think to one. And then when you go read some other real in-depth prophecy portions, it really seems like, no way, it's got to be over in the Middle East. But in other parts, you're like, no, that's got to be America, you know, or New York with the UN or something. And so we're not really going too far down that. But I believe along the way, you will see this Arab, you know, Middle Eastern more so connection. But I'm not saying that that's absolutely where it is, because when you go into Revelation 17, Mystery Babylon, it says sits on, it is what, on many waters, right? Sits on the seven heads, which are the seven mountains, on many waters. There are people, nations, and kings, right? So maybe it's not just one place, or maybe it is a UN type thing. So, but again, we're not going to go too far down that. And the reason I'm going into Daniel 2 to start this, even though if you've been around for a while, we've clearly shown what Daniel 2 and how it relates to the beginning of tribulation going to the end of seals. But I'm specifically doing it because of the head of gold. But listen to what it says, okay? Thou, O king, sawest and behold a great image, okay, whose brightness, and it says what? This image's head was of fine gold, his breasts and arms of silver, his belly and thighs of brass, his legs of iron, and his feet part of iron and part of clay. Thou sawest till that a stone was cut without hands, and smote the image upon the feet that were of iron and clay, and brake them in pieces. So this stone is Christ when he's coming with heavenly Mount Zion. This is when he's coming at the end of the sixth year of seals that everybody sees in Revelation chapter 6. At the end of the sixth seal is the end of this first 6 years of seals. And it's when he's coming and they're hiding in the rocks and mountains fall on us. This is what they're seeing coming. And when he does this, what's he doing? He's crushing the 10 toes. Well, the other prophetic insight of the toes is, of course, the 10 horns of the beast. Okay? So this, it's not a mystery. We've shown it. We understand it's the battle that takes place, the first sword in Revelation chapter 17, when the 10 kings with the beast come and fight against the Lord. Okay? At the end, when he's coming at the end of the sixth year of seals. That's that Ezekiel 39 battle. We even see what? Then what does it become like? It becomes like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. We touched on that in the last video when we broke down what it meant during the 7 years of plenty in relation to Joseph's first 7 years. It had nothing to do with seven good years before the 7 years of tribulation. We were now able, that's why it was so exciting, we were now able to prove that the 7 years of plenty was all about the corn, which meant wheat, that was coming in the seventh year of seals, the great multitude as the sand of the sea. So it was awesome. It's the same context of this timing right here. the end of the sixth year, and then the seventh year is when the great multitude happens. Now, what do we find out about this image? We find out that Nebuchadnezzar is what? He's not all of the image. He's the head of gold.
Excuse me.
He's the head of gold. Okay? And then it says, "And another kingdom, another one shall bear rule over the earth, and the fourth kingdom shall be strong and break in pieces," and so forth. This is the fourth kingdom, which relates to the beast. Some would say the Antichrist, okay? But the beast of Revelation. He is that fourth kingdom being spoken about. So, and he breaks in pieces and so forth. And we know he's going to have that power from about Midas seals to the end of the sixth year, when the stone, which is the Lord coming on heavenly Mount Zion.
Excuse me.
So, the reason I'm bringing this up is because now, when we go into chapter 3, we see Nebuchadnezzar makes an image of gold. So what is essentially, what is he doing? He's making an image, like this whole thing, of gold. But when it was described of what he saw in that first dream, it wasn't all gold, of course. Only the head was of gold. Okay? So in chapter 3, he goes off the deep end, and he gets so prideful, and he makes an image all of gold. But in the image of Daniel 2 that he saw, it really only represents the head. Okay? That's what we're seeing. When he makes this image of gold, it's only the representation of the head. You understand what I'm saying? So as we go forward, we then see Nebuchadnezzar again, and this time he has a second dream. And what we see in this dream is, you see, because when the first vision happened and he saw the whole image and he was told he was the head of gold, then it's like he forgets about it and he gets prideful and he builds a whole image all of gold, of which was the representation of the head of the other image. And then, of course, he's all puffed up and prideful and everything, right? But is he taken away yet? Was he cut down and destroyed yet? No. Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego go into the furnace, right? And then the Lord saves them. And he's like, oh, everybody now needs to worship the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Everybody needs to worship. He is the God of gods. And then he has another dream. So he hasn't been disposed of yet. But then he has another dream. And in this dream, he dreams of a tree reaching to the heights of heaven from the ends of the earth. Now, this doesn't sound very Arab or Middle Eastern. It doesn't sound like there's this kind of power in wherever represents this modern day Babylon. It does sound maybe more so like New York and so forth, right? And maybe through the UN and its reach to the ends of the earth. Okay, so it might be that. But he sees this vision of this tree. And what's really interesting, I don't know if you guys have seen this before, when you go into so many of the definitions of Daniel, this word tree is used 6 times, but it's only in Daniel. It says, and behold, a watcher and a holy one came down from heaven. This word watcher, used 3 times, it's only in Daniel. The holy one is used 13 times. It's only found in the book of Daniel. The word tree again, 6 times, only in Daniel. This word cut off, it's many times in scripture, but only 1 time here in Daniel. This word branches is throughout scripture, 4 times, only in Daniel. You see this in a common theme all throughout Daniel. It's really quite wild within these stories. And I think it's keeping it within Daniel to keep this context of what's taking place prophetically in the years to come, to be able to track it more clearly. Because a lot of times when you go into the definitions, we know when you follow those definitions, it leads to other chapters and other books, right? And then you go in and you try to track them from there. And yes, it brings you more insight. Well, in this case, it's pretty much all confined within Daniel. So we know that he has this vision of a tree whose height is until the end of the earth. And he had, there was a watcher and a holy one that came down from heaven and cried aloud and said, thus hew down the tree and cut off his branches, shake off all of his leaves, scatter the fruit, let them all get from the branches and the tree, the leaves. Nevertheless, leave the stump of his roots. Stump only in Daniel. Roots only in Daniel. See what I'm getting at? The word band only in Daniel. So it says in Daniel 4:15, nevertheless, leave the stump of his roots in the earth, even with a band of iron and brass in the tender grass of the field, and let it be wet with dew of heaven, and let his portion be with the beasts in the grass of the earth. Let his heart be changed from a man's heart unto a beast's heart, and be given unto him, and let seven times pass over. So what we're now seeing is this Nebuchadnezzar who's about to be cut down. Remember, when Daniel then comes and interprets the dream, he says, it is thou, O king, that art grown and become strong, which means Babylon isn't the tree, but the king of Babylon is the tree. And so he's giving them the insight. He's telling the king what it means about this tree. He's letting him know that it means him. And he says, and whereas the king saw a watcher and a holy one coming down from heaven and to hew down this tree and destroy it, yet leave the stump and the roots, he's saying, it is you, and seven times, which is 7 years, will pass over you. Seven times shall pass over thee, till thou know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whosoever he will. So he's saying, you see, there's this pride of Nebuchadnezzar is going to come back. Even though he had seen that first vision, he built that idol, that image of gold, and yet was he removed yet as that head of gold? No, he's still king, right? So the actual image of the head of gold is still in power. He hasn't yet lost that power. And then it says, after thou hast shown, he'll be ruled. So again, we know he's going to be there for 7 years. But now it happens. So in Daniel 4:28, it says, all this came upon the king Nebuchadnezzar. At the end of 12 months, he walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. The king spake and said, is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom, for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty? While the word was still in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven saying, O King Nebuchadnezzar, to thee it is spoken, thy kingdom is departed from thee. So here is that tree now being chopped down, and he's now gonna go spend 7 years, sorry, in the wilderness. So why am I saying this? So if this is the king now being cut down, and he was the head of gold, well then the head of gold has now been cut down. And when he's cut down as the tree, as the head of gold, we know that there were roots of the tree still left in the ground. The stump and the roots were left, kind of like a torso and legs and toes. They were still left. Remember, the kingdom is taken from them, which means Babylon is still there, but the king, who is the head of gold, is gone. So if he's the head of gold and now the head of gold is gone, well, when is the head of gold gone, guys? The head of gold would then be gone at the end of 70 years. Which means we can see this first connection of 70 years, and I'll show you as we get into it, But that means Nebuchadnezzar's time has come to an end. The head of gold is gone. Which, knowing what we know about the end of days, who then do you think and what region of the earth do you believe would then represent Nebuchadnezzar and Babylon? Maybe Babylon grows and it's more than one region. But who would the king be? Because obviously Babylon isn't destroyed. The kingdom is taken from him because he's cut down. So who would the type of modern day Nebuchadnezzar be? Would it be America? Would it be America? You know, is there a prideful Trump that's the type? Maybe. But he's not really the king anymore, right? So, you know, or is it something more clear that we've already come to understand? Iran. Who brings about the first attack? When the pre-trib happens, which we believe will be in that time frame, depending what side of the world you're on, in this time frame of August 12th. From that point, we know 50 days begin from the 9th of Av. And what do we know also happens? There's an attack on Israel by Iran. The two northern cities, of which I know you guys know it very, very well, which relates to Isaiah chapter 9, when Naphtalim and Zebulun, which is a prophetic type of Haifa and Tel Aviv, when they get attacked and destroyed. Well, they get attacked and destroyed at the beginning of 50 days. Who brings about that destruction? Iran. And what happens after Iran brings this attack on Israel? I mean, can we not see it already building? Did not the president just die? Not the Ayatollah, but the president? Right? What happens after that attack? A war breaks out again in the Middle East. Remember what will have happened. The pre-trib, tens of millions of people will have vanished. And right after they're vanishing, Iran launches this attack on Israel, destroying Haifa and Tel Aviv. It's called the light affliction that brings about the end, but obviously the pre-trib brings about the end as well. This will begin the 50 days, that is the portion of time called above, before the 14 years begin on the day and hour no one knows at the Feast of Trumpets. So when Iran destroys Haifa and Tel Aviv, and a short Middle Eastern war, nobody wants it to escalate too crazy because they'll be too afraid that World War III is going to begin. It will be subsided. It'll be a short-lived war. We even have that video from 2010 that confirmed that it won't last for long. And then they're going to, it's going to build, and they're going to be preparing for an inevitable World War III that will come at what? That will begin after 50 days, that will begin on the day and hour no one knows, which is going to be the great affliction from Isaiah chapter 9. It starts with the 50 days in the light affliction. Then we've got the Son of Man, and then Syria with the Philistines being the greater affliction. And that, of course, is what we know is what comes at the Feast of Trumpets. This destruction will be of Jerusalem and will begin the 14 years of tribulation and start nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom at the Red Horse Rider. So if Nebuchadnezzar is destroyed at the beginning and Nebuchadnezzar is the head of gold, and yet there is a root, a stump and roots that remain, meaning because why? Well, there's still something else going on with Babylon. There's still somebody else through his kingdom that's going to be involved. And of course, like I just said, Babylon is still going to be continuing. But what's happening? What would be then the prophetic understanding here in relation to whoever Nebuchadnezzar is? Whoever this prophetic Nebuchadnezzar is, if this is the year, then Nebuchadnezzar's here. He is already in authority, already ruling. Could it be the Ayatollah? Could be. Could it be Trump? Maybe. Depends on what Babylon really is, right? Where it really is. I tend to lead more to the side of Arab, and that this first destruction of the king of Babylon is more so tied to Iran. Is definitely more tied to Iran. So if Iran is the one that brings this attack, and then what happens? Middle East war breaks out. What do you think Israel's going to do to Iran? They're finished. It'll be destruction on Iran. So does that mean Iran can't be Babylon? Or is it mainly to say that Babylon, the king of Babylon, that opened up the scene as the head of gold, was the Ayatollah? So I tend to lean more to this being the Iran leader. But what's interesting about it is when 7 years pass over, that would be a prophetic picture of what? The end of the 7 years of seals. The end of the 7 years of seals. It's like maybe the Ayatollah didn't die. Iran was decimated. Their military was destroyed. The Ayatollah is now gone, but maybe not killed. And the Lord's giving him what? 7 years to repent and to turn. And what happens to Nebuchadnezzar at the end when the 7 years are over? He says, and I was established in my kingdom by and excellency and excellent majesty was added unto me. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the king of heaven, all whose works are true and his ways judgment, and those that walk in pride he is able to abase. You know, sometimes it does maybe seem Trumpish, right? We talked about it before years ago when Trump had that head of gold, right? I don't know if it was a design, if it was real gold or not, but it was prominent back in the time of his first election. And I thought that was interesting, you know, his prideful ways and this bust of gold. And it would be interesting, you know, which would mean he's not going to die, but he's going to be gone out of the picture for 7 years, which would mean what? Well, that would mean he can't be Cyrus. So you see, I'm not saying that he is this Nebuchadnezzar. I'm not saying with certainty who is this Nebuchadnezzar, but understanding that Nebuchadnezzar is the head of gold and taken out of the way first, his portion of his time with his kingdom of gold is gone at the cutting down of the tree, but the stump and the roots are still there, you see, means he's out of the picture. So as we follow this, we then come to 2 Chronicles. So if we go into 2 Chronicles, this is what I was touching on earlier. In 2 Chronicles 36, listen to what this says. So it's talking about Judah's decline. We know that Nebuchadnezzar, right? It was Nebuchadnezzar that attacked Jerusalem and took them captive. Okay? Which means this period is only this beginning portion within the 50 days prophetically. When we look at the chart, if we say, well, 70 years, well, then shouldn't that have happened all the way back 70 years ago? We're talking about events that played out during 70 years, not at the beginning of 70 years. So why would we be looking at an attack by Nebuchadnezzar at the beginning? You see, this is what I'm talking about, that overlapping twisting of prophecy where one portion looks like it's the end and the other portion is the start, yet one seems to be the beginning, one seems to be the end. And we end up with what? 270s. one from Israel when they came into the land and doing the proper count, and one from Jerusalem itself. So watch what happens now. When we go into Second Chronicles, we get the story of the 7 years. Okay, we get the story of the 70 years when Nebuchadnezzar came, destroyed them, and fulfilled 70 years. Okay, that's what we're reading here. They've been destroyed, they've been attacked, and it fulfills the 70 years. Well, what are we talking about? We're talking about it in the 70th year. With 50 days to go in the 70th year, we're going to see that prophetic type of 70 years attack and captivity take place in the 70th year. It's the prophetic type of the 50 days before the 14 years begin. And you'll see how this plays out here, because it related to Jeremiah the prophet, which we'll get into. And we see, so let's go from verse 11, 2 Chronicles 36, 11. Zedekiah was 120 years old when he began to reign, and reigned 11 years in Jerusalem. He did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord his God, and humbled not himself before Jeremiah the prophet, speaking from the mouth of the Lord. And he also rebelled against King Nebuchadnezzar, who had made him swear by God, but he stiffened his neck and hardened his heart and from turning unto the Lord God of Israel. So who refused this turning to the Lord God of Israel? Zedekiah, right? Zedekiah was the one that refused to turn even after this King Babylon attack, right? You have the king of Babylon who attacked, this war that's going to break out, Jews that'll be taken captive, some killed, Babylon routing it and taking things in Israel, taking some of the treasures of Israel, just as it says. Do you guys know who that actually is? Who Zedekiah is? We haven't shared this in quite a while. Zedekiah is, as we just read, right? So Zedekiah was the one who was king at the time, or you could say like Netanyahu in Israel, right? So Netanyahu is the prime minister, but he is a type of king if it was Old Testament talk, right? So Zedekiah was the one there ruling when the time of Babylon came. And Zedekiah was stiff-necked, refused to listen to the prophets, and did evil in the sight of the Lord his God. Refused to listen, and had a stiffened neck and hardened his heart. So who is this Zedekiah? Well, check this out. Those of you who have been around for a while might remember this. 2 Kings 24. Check it out. You ready for this? Verse 17. And the king of Babylon made Methaniah, his father's brother, king in his stead, and changed his name to Zedekiah. Okay? We just saw Zedekiah was there at the time when the attack and all this stuff took place with Babylon and in Israel and in Jerusalem. And we find out that Zedekiah's name wasn't originally Zedekiah. It was Methaniah. Well, that's what it looks like, right? For those who haven't seen this before, are you ready for this? When the king of Babylon comes and attacks, who's there? Metanyahu. Let me say that again. Metanyahu. You mean like Benjamin Netanyahu? Do you see the prophetic typology taking place? Look at what happened. You see, Zedekiah has his name changed from Netanyahu to Zedekiah. Do you guys know the story of Benjamin Netanyahu? Netanyahu's father immigrated to Mandatory Palestine. he Hebrewized his name from Milankowski to Netanyahu. We have an opposite one where Benjamin Netanyahu, his name was really Milankowski, and it was changed to Netanyahu. And we have a Netanyahu who was changed to Zedekiah. And Netanyahu is the leader of Israel as the king right now, at the time of the end, when we're expecting that first attack by Babylon to come, before the head of gold is then removed. What? Pretty wild, right? So now watch what happens. As we go back into 2 Chronicles 36, we now see this wrath of God that had come upon them. Jerusalem is captured and burned. The walls broken down. And then what do we see? It says in verse 20, "And them that had escaped from the sword, he carried away to Babylon, where they were servants to him and his sons till the reign of the kingdom of Persia, to fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah, until the land had enjoyed her Sabbaths. For as long as she lay desolate, she kept Sabbath to fulfill 70 years." So we're now seeing this picture of the end of 70 years. Yet within this picture, Babylon, the head of gold, is still there. And even though the attack is historically related to when they came in 70 years earlier, the prophetic type being played out is the very beginning of the end of days in the 70th year. There isn't something during tribulation that's going to take 70 years to do. This is why I was telling you guys about this right here. Things that took thousands of years won't play out over thousands of years. Things that took decades and centuries won't play out over decades and centuries. They are condensed periods of time. So what we're seeing is an event related to us that was 70 years long being played out in its type in the 70th year by the attack of the modern day Nebuchadnezzar, the head of gold, who will bring about this attack and then be removed in his power. You see? In the 70th year. Because remember, there's 50 days and then you have the 14 years begin. So there's 50 days left in the 70 years of Jerusalem. Look at what happens now. Now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia. So what happens in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia? He makes a proclamation. In verse 23, in 2 Chronicles 36, it says, "Thus saith Cyrus, king of Persia, all the kingdoms of the earth hath the Lord God of heaven given me. And he hath charged me to build him a house in Jerusalem, which is in Judah." See? And so what do most people think the end of days is going to begin with? The rebuilding of the temple. But in Cyrus's day, did he rebuild the temple? No. He never rebuilt the temple, did he? He only laid the foundation. So this proclamation that we're going to get into here that Cyrus makes is the one directly connected to Daniel chapter 9, verse 25. But in verse 24, we have what? 70 weeks. So 70 weeks or 70 years, which is what? A week representing a year prophetically in the end of days. Not 70 times 7 years. It's each week is a year. And what does the word week mean? You guys all know it. It means Shabuah. It means the Feast of Weeks. So it's 70 feasts of weeks were determined. 70 feasts of weeks were determined. And at the 70 feast of weeks that were determined, where do we know the true feast of weeks is? The end of the true seventh Sabbath from the beginning of the wheat harvest. And so when the 70 Sabbaths are determined, what happens? Bam. There's your Nebuchadnezzar as the 70 years being that 70th year. And everything of Daniel 9 now begins the end of days. And then listen to what verse 25 says. Because verse 25 is the proclamation of Cyrus. It says, "Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem." Now, is Jerusalem destroyed on this first attack? No. This is where northern Israel with Iran and so forth and a Middle East war breaks out. And then what happens? Well, we even get some insight into this in 2nd Esdras, right? In 2nd Esdras, the days are coming when the Most High will deliver those who are on the earth. That's the pre-trib. And bewilderment of mind shall come over those who dwell on the earth, right? The whole earth will be caught off guard after the pre-trib is gone. We know that a war breaks out in the Middle East, but it's the short war. This is the one of the Red Horse Rider when they plan to make war against one another, kingdom against kingdom, place against place, so on and so forth, right? That's what we're seeing in relation to this first attack. But this right here, this is a commandment to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem. Jerusalem is an attack and destroyed on the first day of the 50 after the pre-trib. This is just northern Israel. They will settle things down. It will appear to settle. We know the Son of Man begins his 40 days. Son of Man ends his 40 days. And then you've got not many days, 3 days, Acts 2.0 anointing of the Holy Ghost on October 2nd. And then this, the day and hour no one knows. The Feast of Trumpets is the attack by Syria, and that's the one that destroys Jerusalem. Which means after that attack, or at that time frame, who needs to be here? Cyrus. Whoever modern day Cyrus is, must be here. Because he's the one making the proclamation to allow them to go back and to restore and to build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince. Okay? And then it says, unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks. Well, weeks of what? They're Shabuas. So if 70 weeks was 70 years of the Feast of Weeks, then it's saying you've got what? 7 years before it actually starts. That's because it's the 7 years of seals, which means what? They're not actually going to restore and rebuild Jerusalem during the first 7 years of seals after the commandment of Cyrus. But the whole world of prophecy, who only understands 7 years, believes the temple is going to be rebuilt during the first 7 years. But to understand the truth, you have to track the storyline of Cyrus. Of Cyrus, right? So if when the 70 is done, Cyrus is on the scene, and Cyrus gives the proclamation to go and rebuild the city and the streets, but especially the house of God, to allow them to go back and rebuild, then that means whoever modern day Cyrus is the one giving the proclamation at the end of 70 years. So Cyrus now has to be here. And when we go to Daniel 10, excuse me, when we go to Daniel 10, we actually get this insight, don't we? In Daniel chapter 10, now that we know Cyrus is here from the end of the 70s, so beginning the 14 years, he's here for sure during seals in the typology, because as we're going to see, we know in his years only the foundation gets laid. I love it when a plan works out, right? When everything we revealed lays out exactly what scripture is prophetically shown. Only the foundation gets laid during seals, which means here he is, according to Daniel 10, in the third year of Cyrus. In the third year of Cyrus. So if Cyrus is here when 70 years is up, and he's the one that makes the proclamation, and then we get to chapter 10 of Daniel, and it's in the third year of Cyrus, then we're in the third year of seals. How are we able to confirm this? As we go down, and we saw the angel that had come to visit him, we see it says, even in verse 14, look at that wording again. What shall befall thy people, here it is again, in the latter days? Funny how that keeps propping up in these prophetic places, right? He goes on to say, in verse 20, it says, then said he, knowest thou wherefore I am come unto thee, and now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia. Okay, that's the spiritual end and the back end. And when I am gone forth, lo, the prince of Grisha shall come. Who's the prince of Grisha? This is when Arabia comes, right? Yes, in the is or was, it was related to the Greeks. In the is to come, it says also a place in Arabia. Why would it say that? If it was all about the Grecians, why would there just be this little note? Oh, also a place in Arabia. Because prophetically related in the is to come, this entire thing is compassed about by Arabs. The end of days is all about Esau and Jacob. It's all about this Muslim side through the Arabs with their Mahdi, and right, which is the beast or the Antichrist and the false prophet. It is all Arab. So we're seeing in the end, it's giving you the clue. It's telling you also a place in Arabia. Well, that's not till what? In the third year of Cyrus. Which in the third year of Cyrus is exactly the time when we talk about the beast who now comes of Revelation 13, when this time comes to begin 42 months. So he comes in the third year, which leaves half of one, right? Half of the third year, fourth, fifth, sixth. How long is that? 42 months, 3.5 years to the end of the sixth year of seals. And what do you see happen at the end of the sixth year? The Lord coming on Mount Zion, right? The stone coming that's going to destroy the feet, the toes, the right, like the horns. So we can see that Cyrus is definitely at least here in that typology, whoever it might be, to midish seals, about 2.5 years into seals. But is he here longer? I would say he definitely has to be here longer. We can show why he has to be here longer as well. If we go to Jeremiah 39, before I get too far down that other trail, we see the story in Jeremiah here 39. We'll jump back to Cyrus in a second. In Jeremiah 39, with this fall of Jerusalem, we see Nebuchadnezzar, remember? So Nebuchadnezzar is still on the scene. There's Zedekiah. This is all about, like I was saying, remember, even though it was the beginning of 70 and these things played out during 70 years, the prophetic type is the event that's taking place in the 70th year. And how do we know this? Well, because after the first attack, Gedaliah is put in charge. When did the attack take place? On the 9th of Av. So then Gedaliah is put in charge. When Gedaliah is put in charge, and Jeremiah is there, Babylon, through Nebuchadnezzar, is still here. So again, is Nebuchadnezzar dying right away or being removed from power after the Middle East war? Or is it going to happen towards the end of 70 years, right? So what I had just said a moment ago, jumping back, was, you know, when the Nebuchadnezzar type, which I believe is the Iran type, brings about this attack and then the Middle East war is here, is this Nebuchadnezzar Iran type, is he killed? Well, we know he's not killed. Is he totally removed and defeated right away? Well, actually, it doesn't seem like it, because the 70 years doesn't completely end until the 29th of Elul. And so that's what we were seeing in 2 Chronicles 36, to fulfill the 70 years, and then you have the first year of Cyrus show up. So if this is where Babylon, and he's now removed, because then why? Well, then he's gone for 7 years. Does he show up prophetically after the 7 years? No. But it would seem like something happens. He comes back in the sense that he's repented and he's come to believe in the Lord, according to scripture. But he's not back on the scene as king again in relation prophetically. And you'll see that as we get back into Daniel and follow that storyline. So then there's the end of 70, which would mean this would be the time whoever this modern day Nebuchadnezzar is off the scene, and he's now gone for 7 years until he acknowledges the Lord. Why would the Nebuchadnezzar type, if it is Iran, why would he have had this bloated, prideful ego in all this? Well, first of all, he probably already does, but he will have brought destruction on Israel. Hello. Do you know how much he will have accolades and everything poured on him, having brought about destruction on Haifa and Tel Aviv? Tel Aviv is where the offices of government and everything are in Israel. So he's probably going to be held up very highly in the Muslim community. Here, at the end of the 70, is where he's now removed. And that typology of him being gone for 7 years to have some humble pie before he understands it was the Lord's will of what he did and not his own will. It was for the pride of the Jews, the pride of the leadership, the fall of what the people are doing everything in error. And then what? Once he's gone, what do we know happens? Bang! This is Syria. This is the destruction from Syria now on Jerusalem, which means Cyrus is now here. But at some point in this short period, Cyrus is going to make a proclamation to allow them to go back and rebuild. That's what we're seeing. But within those 50 days, we have the first attack. And then what's going to happen? Well, it would seem that the Zedekiah Netanyahu is going to be killed. In fact, it looks like he's going to be killed by Babylon himself, right? It said that he had his eyes pulled out, and you know, it was pretty gruesome. I'm not saying it's going to be verbatim like that, but he's going to be killed. Because what ends up happening is Gedaliah ends up being put in charge, which means after the attack, Gedaliah, somewhere in here, Gedaliah is put in charge. So a modern day Gedaliah will be put in charge because Netanyahu will be killed. And many will flee. It's an attack in northern Israel, two major cities. When Gedaliah is put in charge, Gedaliah only lasted for, I think they said it was about 6 weeks, which is right within the 50 days. What happened at the end of those 6 weeks when Gedaliah became appointed governor of Judah? You see? What you're seeing, just to make it clear for you again, is literally the events of the typology that played out over 70 years are taking place in the 70th year. And it is the king of Babylon, which was Nebuchadnezzar still, who puts Gedaliah in charge. And when Gedaliah is in charge, you have Jeremiah the prophet there. And then what happens? Ishmael comes on the scene. And when Ishmael comes on the scene, we go to Jeremiah 41. We find out in the seventh month, which is what? The seventh month, Feast of Trumpets. They're having a banquet. Ishmael with his 10 men and Gedaliah. And what happens? Ishmael kills Gedaliah and those that were there with him. Now he's killed. That is our 50 days after the pre-trib. It's our 50 days that go from the 9th of Av to the 29th of Elul. That then begins the 14 years, as we've shared many times, at the day and hour no one knows, which is the attack by Syria, the Ishmael type. All of these things are in relation to what? The beginning of the 70 years of Israel's captivity. But you see what's happening. There is no 70 years of Israel's captivity in the end of days. It's a prophetic typology. And so where is it taking place in? The 70th year. The 70th year has it beginning, and then these events playing out that follow. So even though it starts with these events of 50 days, in the final 50 days of the 70th year, it's the prophetic type of what was taking place of Second Chronicles that immediately gets followed by Cyrus. It immediately follows with Cyrus. Yet, what do we know is taking place? Let me show you how this weaves and plays over itself. Because the attack that happened by Nebuchadnezzar at the 9th of Av. From the 9th of Av, he puts Gedaliah in charge. Gedaliah is there as governor. Ishmael comes at the Feast of Trumpets, kills Gedaliah. So you've got the attack of what? The 5th month, which is the 9th of Av, and the 7th month, which is the Feast of Trumpets. Between the two is 50 days, the exact prophetic revelation of the above 14 years that takes place first. But the picture of it is of events that start the 70 years in the was of events that took place. But in the is to come, it is a picture of events that are taking place in the 70th and just in those 50 days of the 70th year while Nebuchadnezzar type is still there. And how do we know again? Because the head of gold. All of this is seals. This is like the 50 days. The rest of this is the rest of seals, to the 6 years of seals, when the 50 days are over, when the head of gold is gone. So even though this head of gold in the was a whole period of 70 years in his kingdom and everything, in the end of days, this plays out over the 50 days in the 70th year. It's wild. It's really wild. And I'm going to show you exactly how this overlaps. One of the best places to do that from is, of course, Zechariah. So we know from Zechariah chapter 1, we've taught on this hundreds of times over the years. When we come to verse 12, halfway through, it says, "How long will thou not have mercy on Jerusalem and on the cities of Judah, against which thou hast had indignation these 70 years? Okay? You can't say these 70 years if it's the 69th year, if it's the 54th year. These 70 years. So currently the 70th year. When we go to Zechariah chapter 7, we know that out of 14 chapters in the 14 years, it's prophetically the seventh year of seals, and he's recalling back to the first year when everything began. How do we know? As you guys know, from Zechariah 7, verse 5 and 7, everything is past tense to those 70 years that already passed. It says, speak unto the people of the land and to the priests, saying, when you fasted, all past tense, and mourned in the fifth and seventh month. Why is there this conversation of a fasting and mourning that the Jews have done for 70 years in the fifth and seventh month when they did them those 70 years ago? Do you see what's happening? He's saying in the 70 years when you do the proper Leviticus 19 count, when you come into the land, you understand how to count it. Those 70 years, Zechariah 1 says, these 70 years, Zechariah 7, as the seventh year seals, says, those 70 years, during all of those 70 years, in the fifth and seventh month, fasting and mourning, this is the fifth month, ninth of Av is the fifth month, fasting and mourning, and the seventh month, it's the third of Tishri, but really the third of Tishri, the reason they observe the fasting in the morning of the seventh month on the third is because the event itself happened on the Feast of Trumpets. So they don't want to observe it on the Feast of Trumpets because it's the Feast of Trumpets. So the fasting and mourning of the fifth month and the fasting of the morning on the seventh, which is the event that happened on the Feast of Trumpets. Why is it prophetically showing us or telling us that for 70 years they fasted and mourned on the fifth and seventh month that relate to the attacks of the fifth and seventh month that happened 70 years earlier, and they were in the land for 70 years that they were in captivity? You have this overlap that's taking place. You have the events of 70 years, like this row right here under Tuesday. You have the events of what took place for 70 years, the fifth and the seventh month attack, and they're in captivity for 70 years. And then you come to Zechariah, and Zechariah tells you chapter 1, these 70 years. So you're in the 70th year. Zechariah 7 says those 70 years, and is saying, for those 70 years, when you fasted and mourned, did you at all do it unto me? Is he saying that during those 70 years, you were in the captivity, like the Nebuchadnezzar captivity? No. He's saying, since you've been in the land again for 70 years, and you were fasting and mourning during the 70 years, to observe the fasting and mourning of what took place hundreds of years earlier in the fifth and seventh month, for those 70 years that you've been in the land, had you been doing it unto me? So you've got this overlay of this picture of 70. The 70 is clearly over, and they've been in the land for 70 years, yet the picture within the 70 years that they're in the land is throwing it back to when they were in captivity for 70 years based on the first attack and then the second attack that came. It's literally overlaying them currently having been in the land for 70 years, relating to a far distant was when they were in captivity, because of the events of the fifth and seventh month when they were in captivity for 70 years. So you see how, even though it looks like this picture of, you know what, the end of days is going to be 70 years of them in captivity again? No. It's actually a picture of them having been in the land already for 70 years and being asked, hey, that fifth and seventh month, did you guys observe that properly, even unto me, for those 70 years? And so what is it giving us this clue of? Another event in the 70th year that's taking place at the fifth and seventh month. And what was it in the far distant was with Babylon? It was the attack by Babylon at the beginning, right, of the, at the beginning of the 50 days, and then it was the attack by Ishmael at the end of 50. And here he is saying in Zechariah, it is the 70th year, and then going to chapter 7 saying, hey, back when it was those 70 years, and he reiterates what was taking place in the 5th and 7th month. It's wild to follow. It's really wild to track how that plays out. So now you're seeing this. Where was I? Now you're seeing what's happening here with this Zedekiah Netanyahu. You're seeing that it's the 70th year. You're seeing this 50-day portion that it related to. We know that the 50 days is even prophetically playing over again in Isaiah 9 with the light affliction before the great affliction, and of course with the Son of Man here for 40 days in the midst of it. Now, again, this is all still tracking from Daniel, because what followed next, so that's where I went off a little bit, and now coming back to Daniel in relation to Nebuchadnezzar, the head of gold, is now gone. The time of Nebuchadnezzar is done, and 70 years have come to an end, and Cyrus is on the scene, and he's the one who makes the proclamation to allow them to go back and rebuild. Only it tells us they're not going to rebuild for the next 7 years during seals. But they're going to do something, but they're not actually going to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. The only thing that'll get built is the foundation. We know Cyrus is here, because if it's the third year, if he's there, first year of Cyrus is the end of 70. So at the time of trumpets, after Jerusalem is now attacked, Cyrus is now on the scene at the start of the 14 years. And in Daniel 10, we can prove that he's here to the third year, as I said earlier, because when Grisha shows up, this is all about when the beast comes. This is when the beast shows up, who is the was, is, and is to come, who is the eighth, who is of the seven. And I'm going to prove that to you. You're going to see as we progress through this in Daniel that we can prove it based on this year count being given. So when we, I covered all that. When we go now to Ezra chapter 1, let's go see our brother Ezra chapter 1. Here we get that proclamation of Cyrus. Okay, so the proclamation of Cyrus is to go and what? To rebuild Jerusalem, right? To rebuild and really to bring about the laying of the foundation. And you might say, well, wasn't the proclamation to allow them to go back and to rebuild and to build the temple? Well, it was. And we see that actually in, is it Isaiah 44? Excuse me. In Isaiah chapter 44, the Lord's chosen, and we see here in verse 28, thus saith of that saith of Cyrus, he is my shepherd and shall perform all my pleasure, even saying to Jerusalem, thou shalt be built, and to the temple, thy foundation shall be laid. Now, remember what I was just saying about Cyrus. We know he's there from the beginning, excuse me, of the 14 years. Now that the head of gold is gone, which would appear to be Iran, and now Cyrus is here. We know Cyrus is definitely here till at least the third year, because we know that in the third year from in Daniel 10 is the third year of seals, because that's the point when Grisha, who is the beast portion of Arabia, comes and the beast begins. But is Cyrus here prophetically longer than this image of the first year to the third year? Well, I believe he is, and we can prove it. Because in Cyrus, with Cyrus, I mean, we know that Cyrus made the decree, right? And we see right here in the story of Cyrus the Great, it says, I have also sent my treasurers and Zerubbabel, the governor of the Jews, that they may lay the foundation of the temple. Okay? That they might lay the foundation of the temple. Who's the one responsible for laying the foundation? Zerubbabel is. This is something that's really important for us, because as we went into Zechariah, and as we have many times over the years, we just saw this prophetic overlay of what starts like 70 years beginning in the story, yet it's really a picture of in the 70th year, in the final 50 days, represented as that period of time of the head of gold before Nebuchadnezzar's done, for which when the 70 years is over, the head of gold is gone, and who's here? Cyrus is here. And the modern day Cyrus, now he begins his 7 years, and I'm going to show you he's not the only one here, by the way. But what did we see also? We saw the 70 years. And it was the 70 years from when they were in the land for 70 years, not having been in captivity for 70 years. So in this end of 70 years, in this Daniel 9, 70 years ending, and then the 14 years starting, in this picture, we are seeing the same story in Zechariah. Because who does Cyrus send to rebuild? Zerubbabel. And even though in Daniel 10, we know that Cyrus is here till the third year, is he prophetically here also till the end of seals? Right? At least till the end of the sixth, maybe to the seventh year of seals prophetically? I believe he is. And how can I show you that? Because Zerubbabel is the one rebuilding the temple. But he only lays the foundation during the time of seals. So what do we know about this in the 14 chapters of Zechariah, like the 14 years of seals? We know Zerubbabel is the one who lays the foundation. So in Zechariah 4:9, the hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this house, his hands shall also finish it. We've studied on this and taught on this many times. We know the temple starts to get built in the first year of trumpets. Just like Zechariah chapter 8 represents the first year of trumpets, it says, let your hands be strong, because now they're going to rebuild. So if Zerubbabel is the one who lays the foundation, and only the foundation is laid during seals, and it happens in chapter 4 of what we understand is the 14 years in the chapters to years, then that means the foundation is laid in the fourth year. Who gave the authority to go and rebuild it? Cyrus. Cyrus did. And so if Zerubbabel is rebuilding it in the fourth year, is Cyrus not there? How can we prove this is really in the fourth year? You know, there's other scriptures that talk about the was that happened in the second year. But the real prophetic revelation is it happening this time in the is to come. It will happen again in the fourth year. And we see here that Zerubbabel has it laid in the fourth year. Where else do we see it? In 1 Kings chapter 6. In 1 Kings chapter 6, we got that same story, right? 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 37 and 38. In the fourth year was the foundation of the house of the Lord laid. In the 11th year. So from the beginning of what? If this is the fourth year, then there had to be a start, right? So from year one to year four, in the fourth year, the foundation is laid. And then in the 11th year, the house is finished. And what do we know about this in relation to Zechariah? It's exactly the story, right? In the fourth year, the foundation is laid by Zerubbabel. And then we go to chapter 8, which is the start of trumpets. After the foundation is laid, what happens for the next 3 years? 3.5 years, say mid fourth year. What happens? Nothing. Once the foundation is laid, everything is interrupted and stopped, and they're not able to build anymore. It's not until the Lord has returned at the end of the sixth year, which is exactly what we see here, when we see Joshua, the high priest and king, which is a picture of Jesus, and the branch, who is Zerubbabel, who's going to rebuild and finish the temple. You see, who's going to build the temple on the foundation that he laid? It said that he's going to be the one to finish it. So we've got now the Lord who came with that stone. We have the Lord who came, who crushes them at the end of the sixth year of seals and becomes a great mountain. He is the Messiah ben Joseph. He is the Joshua high priest and king. And now what happens? There's the seventh year of seals, and then you have the first year of trumpets. The Lord is there on Mount Zion. It's the mountain of the Lord, and you guys all know this very well. Zechariah 8:9, let your hands be strong, you that hear in those days these words by the mouth of the prophets, which were in the day that the foundation of the house of the Lord of hosts was laid, that the temple might be built. So what do you got? Foundation laid in the fourth year. Then they're pushed off and they're not able to finish during the rest of seals. First year of trumpets comes around. They're now starting to rebuild. And after 3.5 years, in the 11th year, the temple is now finished. The temple is now finished. It is absolutely exactly worded to the timing from Zechariah in its book, from 4 through 11, as it is laid out right here in 1 Kings 6:36-38. It's awesome. It's absolutely awesome. So in Cyrus's time, as I said, the only thing we know that gets laid is the foundation, which means if the foundation isn't laid till the third year, then that means we have Cyrus from the beginning of the 14 years. We know in Daniel 10, he's there in the third year. The foundation is done in the fourth year, so Cyrus must still be there. You see? So is there a cutting off of Cyrus at some point, or does he actually appear to go to the end of seals? It does appear he gets to go to the end of seals. You'll see as we keep going through this. When we go back to Ezra chapter 1 and we follow the storyline, we see there he is. He gives the proclamation. They're going to start rebuilding. Let your hands be strengthened. And we also see right here, remember Zerubbabel? So this is why it's so awesome. You're directly tracking from 2 Chronicles 36 into Daniel, into Ezra, into Zechariah. It says, all these did Sheshbazzar. Who is Sheshbazzar? Zerubbabel. It's Zerubbabel's Persian name. So, of course it's Zerubbabel, right? Because the 14 years have begun, and it's Zerubbabel who's brought back into Jerusalem, and this rebuilding is going to start, for which they will only complete the foundation, as you guys know. Okay, so what's this? This is from Josephus. In the first year of his reign, which was the 70th, you see that? From the day that our people were removed out of the land. So again, in the 70th, right at that time, right, that end of those 50 days, right in that period, he makes that proclamation and so forth. All right. So We're seeing what's happening. We're seeing that he made it. We see that it's Zerubbabel brought back. Now, before I go further into Ezra, let's get back into Daniel. We now see and understand that when Nebuchadnezzar is cut off, probably right towards the end of the 50 days in the 70th year, we see that a stump of his roots is left. And we know that Babylon is, of course, still here. Babylon wasn't destroyed yet. Just Nebuchadnezzar, the head of gold over Babylon. And there's a stump in roots. Now watch what happens when we go to chapter 5. We have to understand these things. You see, when things jump in places, and there's no, like, where's the break from the one to the other? Where did this one end and all of those others continue? Well, if you want to study those things out in a historical reference, it's not very difficult, right? Enough people have done it. You can go back and track that period, and then this one came, and that one came, and you could track all that for the events that actually, how they all laid out. But prophetically, how one lays out compared to the other and with the other over the other and how they intertwine, the reasoning in it and the ability to find it is based on what is written in the scriptures. We just went from the end of the 70 years and Nebuchadnezzar being removed. When this happens in the prophetic type, we know that Cyrus shows up. We've just covered that with Cyrus. But we also have to remember that when he was cut down, there was still a stump and roots. So now when we go to chapter 5, why does it suddenly just jump to Belshazzar? Why didn't it just continue with more of the other events from Nebuchadnezzar when he came back? Because there is a prophetic purpose within the word. There are reasons certain parts are omitted and other parts are not. It's to reveal was, is to come. It's all purposed. And so what do we see now? We know that, actually, let's go over here. We know that at this point now, Cyrus is here. But is it only Cyrus? Or is there somebody else also? Watch what happens. You see, Cyrus is the king of Persia. But you're going to see something happen with Cyrus. But still, at the beginning, he's king of Persia. And there's still Babylon. And who's in charge now of Babylon? Well, if Nebuchadnezzar is gone, and we're being told that Belshazzar is here in Daniel 5. Hello. Belshazzar is here in chapter 5 after Nebuchadnezzar. Yet we were able to just show that Daniel was here. Cyrus was here. So is it possible then that at the end of 70 years, the stump and root that took over is Belshazzar? So whoever the prophetic Belshazzar might be could be here at the same time while Cyrus is here? I can prove it to you. We don't know who these actual characters will be, but they will be front and center as all of this plays out, and we will come to know who they are for those who are remaining to work. So look at what we see about Belshazzar. He ends up what? They end up having a little wine party. A little party with wine, with all of the silver and gold and everything that his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of Jerusalem. Well, this is what we're talking about. If the attack is happening in the time of the 50 days, and you've got the first and the second attack and this devastation and taking riches and stuff from Jerusalem in the 70th year, then when he shows up, what would be the season that he's showing up in now that Nebuchadnezzar is gone? Well, we know that Cyrus has shown up, but according to Daniel 5, we now have this Belshazzar guy showing up. And what's the first thing it relates to us with Belshazzar? They're drinking wine. They're drinking wine. And by the way, this wine, yeah, you guessed it, only in Daniel. Strange, right? They're drinking wine. Belshazzar shows up, and the first thing it says about him is they're drinking wine out of the vessels and everything that they stole, that his father stole, the Nebuchadnezzar of gold stole during this attack. And he's drinking wine. At what? Literally at the time of wine. Elul 29 is the true Pentecost, the 50 days after the seven Sabbaths. It's literally wine harvest season. And what were they accused of being drunk on in Acts chapter 2? They were being accused of being drunk on new wine. When Ishmael came and brings that second attack at the Feast of Trumpets to start the 14 years, nation against nation, which begins with Jerusalem, when was the date it happened? Feast of Trumpets, and what were they doing? They had gathered wine. Belshazzar suddenly shows up in the prophetic type after the 70 years, and the first thing he's in trouble for doing is drinking wine with all the derelicts and everybody else out of the vessels that Nebuchadnezzar, the head of gold, stole in that first portion of 50 days. See how it works? See how it works? Could have said they were eating bread. No, they were drinking wine. Could have been anything, but no, they were drinking wine right at the timing that this would equal. Now watch what happens. We end up with the story of the writing on the wall, right? And we have Daniel here, which is of the captivity of Judah, whom the king, my father, brought out of Jewry. Well, remember what happens? When they're attacked, there's going to be fleeing. They're going to be taken captives. The end of days have begun. Even though the craziness will really begin after at the Feast of Trumpets, of course it's already started. Tens of millions of people have vanished. Middle Eastern war breaks out, begins with Nebuchadnezzar type. There will be captives brought out of what? Judah. The children of Judah. Exactly, because it is the Jews who are in the land right now. And then look what happens. He needs Daniel again. So he has Daniel come and try to explain to him the writing on the wall. And Daniel's like, look, you keep your goods, you keep your gifts, I don't need your rewards, even though the guy ends up giving them to him, right? But what happens? He's like, look, you didn't even realize it. It happened to your father, for crying out loud. It was in your father's kingdom, and he did this, and you don't remember to learn from it? Now, it's coming to you. You're about to be disposed as your father was. And what happens? It says he talks about his father again until his father realized what was going on. And then he says in Daniel 5:22, and thou, his son, O Belshazzar, has not humbled thine heart, though thou knewest all of this. Okay, you knew everything that happened to your father, and you get all prideful in this and end up doing this type of thing. Well, guess what happened? Here is the definition. Here is the revealing of the writing on the wall. And it says that God has numbered thy kingdom and finished it. Thou art weighed in the balances and art felt wanting. And thy kingdom is divided and given unto the Medes and Persians. Then he said he makes him ruler over all. Now listen to this. That he should be ruler over all in the kingdom. In that night was Belshazzar, the king of the Chaldees, slain, and Darius, listen carefully, and Darius the Median took the kingdom, being about 62 years old. Look at this Darius. This is actually Darius, not Cyrus. This is actually Darius, not Cyrus. Do you know why this is important? Let me explain. Darius, you see, Cyrus comes first. Cyrus gets the foundation done right with Zerubbabel. He makes the decree. He's there to start the 14 years after 70. The temple is laid. He's the one that got Zerubbabel to be there. It is Zerubbabel that does it. In the fourth year, it's done. So Cyrus is clearly still there. But then we have Darius. Do you guys know what happened with Darius? We have Darius, but Darius doesn't show up until after, right? He doesn't show up until after Cyrus. Watch this. Let's go back. Let's go to Ezra chapter 4. We saw Ezra chapter 1 was of course Cyrus. And now we're talking about Darius. We see now when the adversaries, listen to this, of Judah and Benjamin. Who are Judah and Benjamin, guys? The Jews, the house of Judah, those who are in the land. So it says, now when the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard that the children of the captivity build the temple, they want to take part, right? We all know the story. There's Zerubbabel rebuilding. Jeshua, no, I don't believe actual Yeshua will be there yet. It'll be Zerubbabel, though, rebuilding. The actual prophetic Yeshua comes at the end of the sixth seal. And what happens? Well, they were rebuilding everything except, as we know, and as we have taught many times, in all the period of seals, the only thing that gets built is in the fourth year, the foundation of the temple is finished. That's it. Because we know in Zechariah 8, they're going to start now rebuilding the city and the streets and the temple on the foundation that was laid during seals. So, listen to what it says. It says, then the people of the land weakened the hands of the people of Judah and troubled them in building. And it says, and hired counselors against them to frustrate their purpose all the days of Cyrus, the king of Persia, even until the reign of Darius, the king of Persia. You see what's going on? Darius doesn't show up until the end of the 6 years of seals, which means Cyrus was there as we've been building this in Cyrus's revelation here to be able to show that Cyrus is there at the beginning of the 14 years. He's there to make the decree. He brings in Zerubbabel and them to start to rebuild. They start to rebuild, but only get the foundation laid. They're trying to do more. Excuse me. They're trying to do more, but they're frustrated by the world that's now preventing them. So in the prophetic end of days, we know that only that foundation is going to be laid during seals. And they're giving it a push. They're trying to do more, but they're not going to be able to. Why aren't they going to be able to? Because in the third year, who shows up? It starts to get difficult. Not immediately, but it really starts to get difficult. Right? The Grecian, which is Arabia. And so they start in the end of days. It's because the beast is now showing up. And it's not going to be able to do anything else. They're not going to be able to do anything else except having laid the foundation. Which means in this type, we're seeing Cyrus till the end of the sixth year of seals time frame. And it says until the reign of Darius, king of Persia. Which would mean Darius is a prophetic type of the one who comes at the start of the seventh year of seals. Wait a second, you mean when Jesus shows up? Yes. When the Lord returns as the stone crushes the ten toes, the ten horns. Right? And those 10 kings that come against them. It's the same prophetic typology in the timing as when Darius comes. I can prove it to you, because this Daniel portion that we saw with Belshazzar, I can show that Belshazzar is now here till the end of 6 years of seals, just as Cyrus is here till the end of seals, the end of the 6 year of seals. And we can first of all show it by showing that Belshazzar is killed at the end of seals when Darius shows up. So when Darius is showing up at the end of the 6 year of seals, which is the timing when the Lord comes on Mount Zion as the stone, that means Belshazzar was here during seals. And if Darius is the one that takes over after Cyrus, then that means Cyrus is here till the end of the 6 year of seals. So now watch what happens in relation to Darius. Darius shows up. We see they were rebuilding, right? They're in Ezra chapter 5. They're explaining how they were rebuilding. They were looking to build the house. They were getting ready to set up the walls and do all those things until all these people came and frustrated and stopped it. And then it says in verse 5, but in the first year of Cyrus, listen to what they called him, the king of Babylon. The king of Babylon. So you've got Cyrus, who's now also called the king of Babylon. Because why? Because Babylon never left just because Nebuchadnezzar was gone. This whole thing is Babylon. The whole system of the end is Babylon, of which there will be different ruling kings over certain defeats and over certain victories. So we keep going and we see who made Zerubbabel, who made him governor, who laid the foundation. And then it says, verse 16, then came the same Zerubbabel and laid the foundation of the house of God, which is in Jerusalem. And since that time, even until now, hath it been in building, and it is not yet finished. So they stopped them in all of these decrees, only the foundation being laid. Then we come to chapter 6 of Ezra, and listen to what it says. Then Darius the king made a decree to what? To search out in the house of the rolls where the treasures were laid up in Babylon. End of seals. Babylon is still here. Huh. And what is he looking for? He's looking for the record of the decree in the first year, which is the first year of seals, in the first year of King Cyrus, that they would let the foundation thereof be strongly laid. Now, what happens when he finds the decree? He finds this decree that he was allowed to go back and to restore. And then it says in Ezra 6:7, let the work of the house of the Lord God, let the work of this house of God alone, let the governor of the Jews and the elders of the Jews build this house of God in his place. We keep reading, let it be done with speed. When Darius makes this decree, okay, you definitely want to hear this, because Darius, where is it, was it 5? We end up finding out that Darius is the one that allows them to go back and to get the rebuilding starting again. But we know it has to be at the end of 6 years of seals. That Darius, at the same timing of Christ, is calling for this rebuilding to continue. And it says, where is it? Oh, where is it? In the course of the Levites. You end up finding out, let me go up into my notes up here, that Darius, he, allows the temple to get rebuilt, and he does it in his second year. Same walls were built again, so this is where they were fighting to stop it. And here it is. It was in chapter 4, in Ezra chapter 4. So we see them. See, they keep saying if. So in Ezra 4 verse 13, be it known now unto the king that if the city be builded and the walls set up again. You see, so they only got the foundations done. The walls aren't set up yet. The city isn't rebuilt yet. That's why in Daniel chapter 7, from the decree of Cyrus, only the foundation is laid during those 7 years. And it says 7 year or 7 weeks, which are years. And then it says, comma, and the city, the streets, and the temple will be rebuilt. Because we know it won't happen until the first year of trumpets, that it'll start again, just like Zechariah 8 showed. Why is this important? In Ezra chapter 4, 16, it says, we certify the king that if this city be builded again and the walls thereof set up. So again, in seals, saying, look, we can't allow them to do it. We can't allow them to do it. But the foundation had already been laid. Now, who comes on the scene? Now we've got Darius coming, right? Now Darius comes onto the scene. We know that he's going to look through the scrolls, as we saw. Darius is going to look through the scrolls, allow them to go and to rebuild all of this stuff, right? When do you think, if Darius shows up at the end of the sixth year of seals, and we know that the temple and the city and streets aren't going to start getting rebuilt until the first year of trumpets, when do you think should be the prophetic typology of what took place with Darius? It should be the second year, right? Because if Darius shows up at the end of the sixth year, like when Messiah comes, okay, start of the seventh year, Darius now shows up. Cyrus's time was done. Belshazzar is dead. It's the same as the start of the seventh year of seals. So you've got 1 year of seals, which is the seventh year, 1 year of seals left. And then you've got the first year of trumpets, which would be what? This would be Darius's first year. This would be Darius's second year. So the first year of trumpet judgments would be the second year of Darius, correct? Not hard to follow, right? Darius shows up, start of the seventh year of seals. That's 1 year in. The start of the first year of trumpets would be the equivalent of Darius's second year. What do we know happens in the first year of trumpets, which would be Darius's second year? They start to rebuild the city, streets, and temple. Look what Ezra says. Ezra chapter 4, verse 24. Then ceased the work of the house of God, which was at Jerusalem. So it ceased, listen to this, unto the second year of the reign of Darius, king of Persia. What? Exactly. Exactly the timing. Cyrus shows up, makes the decree. They'll rebuild only the foundation. They get stumped and aren't able to continue on with the rest of it, because who shows up in the third year? You've got the beast showing up. So the foundation gets finished and everything else gets thrown into out of whack. You've got the Belshazzar, who's also here in the same time as Cyrus, and their prophetic typology, their timing, comes to an end at the end of the sixth year of seals. Then you've got the Darius king showing up at the start of the seventh year of seals, which is the same prophetic timing as when the Lord shows up at the end of the sixth to start the seventh year of seals, which would mean Darius's second year is the first year of trumpets. And what do we know begins the first year of trumpets? Zechariah chapter 8 when chapter 4 had the fourth year, when First Kings had the fourth year for the foundation, when we get to chapter 8, we know 5, 6, and 7th year were confounded and events going on that they couldn't complete the rest, only to find out that in the first year of trumpets, the Lord is there, and they're allowed to now go back and to start rebuilding, to let their hands be strong. And in the prophetic type, it's not the first year of Christ here, it's the picture of the second year of Christ. The first year was the seventh year of seals, when he sealed the 144, he brought in the great multitude rapture, he makes a covenant. Then at the first year of trumpets, which is the second year that he's here, the rebuilding of the city streets and temple with Zerubbabel, who laid the foundation, will then do it. The exact same prophetic type being the second year of Darius. I find that fascinating, guys, because we're able to track all these things from prophecies that we've revealed in the prophetic of all of this is to come over the years, giving us more clarity, more insight, more absolute confirming understanding. Now we go back. We go back into Daniel. We see Darius is here. See, Darius in chapter 6. It pleased him to put 120 princes over the priests. He's over the realm, putting priests over them, decree to establish. And then, what does it say? That Daniel, the captivity. Let's see what we're going to do here. Oh, man, there was so much stuff. The dwelt nation, dwelt upon the earth, make a decree. It's so good. Let me keep my track, because what we end up finding out here now too is we spoke about Cyrus, and we could show that the seals portion of the first 6 years of seals was Cyrus. We showed where Darius comes in at the start of the seventh year of seals, and he's the one that allows the rebuilding, which is directly going into the time of trumpets when the Lord is here. But what about the Belshazzar? How can we also prove, outside of when Belshazzar's time ends, it says it's when Darius shows up. So how else can we prove that Belshazzar, the Belshazzar type, is also here for the 6 years of seals? Watch this. Here's Belshazzar. We know it was wine. We know he has his time until the writing on the wall. And it's when Darius comes. That's really all we have here to show that it's till the end of the sixth year of seals. But watch what happens when we go forward. In Daniel chapter 7, we know Daniel chapter 7 very well, right? Four great beasts. We have the lion, the bear, the leopard, and then we have the fourth beast. Who's the fourth beast, guys? Grisha. Grisha. Grisha is the fourth beast. But what is the beginning of this? When does the lion come in the end of days? It's the beginning of the 14 years. Remember, the lion is Syria. The lion is Syria. The lion is the Ishmael. It's the one who brings the first attack from the north. This is the lion. And remember, Assad's name used to be, now it's Bashar al-Assad, which means the lion. But it used to be Bashar something else his last name used to mean the beast. So his last name went from the beast to the lion. I love that, man. You see, these insights of things that are in our reality right now. He is from the north. He is the Syria. It even tells us in Isaiah, Syria. He is the Arab. And it says that he is a beast who is a lion. And his name was beast and is now lion. It's like Netanyahu, you know, had his name changed from another name to Netanyahu. And the one who would be there in the 70th year was Netanyahu and changed to Zedekiah. And Netanyahu name change. I mean, these are things happening in the prophetic reality. When we go to Jeremiah chapter 4, you see this about the lion. It's the lion that brings the attack first, right? Destruction from the north where? On Judah and Jerusalem. It's all about Judah and Jerusalem because it's the Jews who are in the land right now. And what does it say? Blow ye the trumpet in the land, because it's going to be at the Feast of Trumpets. And it says, the lion is come up from his thicket, and the destroyer of the Gentiles is on his way. Okay? So you got the lion come up from his thicket, and the destroyer of the Gentiles is on his way. Who's the destroyer of the Gentiles on the way? That's the bear. Okay? The bear, Russia. So when we go back now into Daniel 7, knowing what we've already known for a while, that it's Syria, the lion, who is bringing this attack at the Feast of Trumpets to begin the 14 years, when the Cyrus type is also there, who is the Belshazzar? Can we prove that Belshazzar is a type who's also there at the same time? Yes, we can. Daniel 7, verse 1. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon. So we've got Belshazzar and we've got Osiris overlapping each other at this time. We've got this Belshazzar character in the first year. In his first year, which is a prophetic picture of the first year of trumpets of tribulation beginning. How do we know it? Because that's exactly what this is that we've broken down before. The lion comes first, is the destruction against Jerusalem. The bear comes, which is World War III breaking out against the Gentiles, right? The Gentile nations. It starts with Jerusalem. It then goes to the world, House of Israel, probably House of Israel with a focus on America first, being the most powerful. They're going to have to be brought down quite a bit before it all breaks out worldwide. Then we've got the leopard, which is through, you know, Germany or that group of European nations, maybe World Economic Forum and so forth. They're going to be the control center of the coming beast system. And then what happens? Bang. The fourth beast shows up. The fourth beast is the beast of Revelation 13 and 17 and so forth. He's the one with the 10 horns. Who is he? Well, watch this. Look what happens when we go to chapter 8. The third year of Belshazzar. Hello. Didn't we just have a first year and a third year of Cyrus? And we can show that it was the beginning of tribulation to the third year. And then we know the temple, the foundation and so forth. And then we were able to show, if Darius shows up after Cyrus's reign, and Cyrus's reign only got the foundation laid, and then Darius shows up, and then we were able to also show that Belshazzar was here, but Belshazzar will have his reign until the writing on the wall. And it's until what? Until the end of the sixth year of seals as well. And then we find Cyrus year one. We find Cyrus year three. Now we find Belshazzar year one, showing from the scriptures of Daniel 7, where we know it's prophetically speaking to the first year of tribulation, only to then end up in Daniel 8, which is the third year of tribulation and the third year of seals. And how do we know it? Listen to this. What do we know about what happens here? Daniel 8:3, remember? Something we taught on a couple times recently, but especially the big teaching on it. We have two horns that are called mountains. These two horns come across another horn, which is a goat, which is also a mountain. So you have two mountains, you have a third mountain. And the third mountain destroys the other two. So there's only one mountain. And then that mountain, which is the third, ends up with his horn broken. So now three mountains are broken. And four more mountains come up. Remember, every one of these horns in Daniel 8 are called mountains. So there were three of them. Then the third one dies, and the fourth, the next four come up together. So we had three plus four, that's seven. And then out of one of the seven, you see, which is one of the final four, a little horn comes up who's exceedingly great, who waxes great, who will cast the host of heaven to the ground and trample the stars and stamp them and stamp upon them. Who is this little horn? It's a mountain. There were seven mountains, and from the last four, which is the seventh one of them, another one shows up who would be the eighth, who is of the seven. Who is he, and when does he show up? Doesn't he show up in the third year of seals? Doesn't he show up in the third year of seals? Didn't Cyrus also tell us in his third year with Daniel, in the time of the end, that when Grisha will show up? And when we go back to Daniel 7, we find out that that's the fourth beast. This is the fourth beast that will stamp the residue with his feet. And then we get more details because we find out he's the one with the 10 horns. So who is he? Of course, Revelation 17, we know he's the beast. Because the beast that we were told that had, see, and the beast that carries her, which has seven heads and 10 horns. Seven heads. So the beast of Revelation has seven heads and 10 horns. And the beast that you saw was, this is the portion we're talking about, right? The was, that second half of seals when he comes. Then we know he is not, because he's going to be killed at the end of seals. And then he's going to come back again at mid-trumpets when he comes out of the bottomless pit. What are we told about him? We are told that the seven heads, which the beast has, are seven mountains. Seven mountains. You mean like Daniel 8, the seven mountains? And then what happened from the seven? Another little eighth one came from the midst of the seventh one? And that this beast that has seven heads also has 10 horns? And what happens to the seven heads? There were seven kings. Five are fallen. One is. The other is not yet come. And when he comes, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is what? The eighth. He's the eighth. So he's what? He's the eighth mountain that came from and is of the seven. He's from the seven mountains. He is the eighth mountain to come up from among the seven. He is the beast that was, which is the second half of seals, is not, because he's destroyed for the end of seals and he won't be there for the first half of trumpets, only to come back at mid-trumpets. And what does he have? 10 horns. So when we're seeing him here now in Daniel chapter 7, and we know who he is from chapter 8, we now know that this fourth beast is the eighth mountain from among the seven, because it is this eighth one who is the beast over it all, and he's the one that has the 10 horns. Not hard to track anymore, is it? It even told us in the third year, which means this Belshazzar character is here in the third year. Why would Belshazzar be here? Well, if the head of gold, who was Nebuchadnezzar, if the head of gold, excuse me, who was Nebuchadnezzar, is gone at the time at the end of 50 days, but the stump and the roots have remained because it's Babylon, how fitting that Belshazzar, his son, is still here during this time as well. Excuse me. You see, it's not all about just one character. There are so many key characters that are playing out throughout all of this in the end of days. We've known for a long time there's a Cyrus type. We've known there is Babylon, but there's not just going to be this one single ruler over Babylon. There's going to be different portions of time. These battles and these wars that are going to take place during tribulation aren't going to be things that have to play out over years of battles anymore. We're talking advanced weapon invasions and all of these things and drones and everything else. There's probably going to be some changing out of things going on. But now we can start to track this so much better. And all of this is during seals until the stone comes that crushes it all. When the stone comes, who's finished? The beast of Revelation, who is the eighth, who is of the seven, who has the 10 horns, which are a picture of also the 10 toes, because the 10 toes come to fight against the Lord. And they are the 10 toes and 10 horns. They are part of the beast because the beast has the 10 horns. And yet at the same time, it will have been the end of the portion where Cyrus had his role in it, where Cyrus was the one to strengthen and allow the Jews to go back until the beast really throws things off and they're not able to finish rebuilding. You see, all of these things that have already taken place are prophetically revealed to us exactly like Ecclesiastes 1:9 said. What was shall be, what is shall be. You know what you see in this? It's just like Babylon. Okay, so how many Babylons were there in history? There were two. So we've got this picture of two. It's almost like one and then it kind of a continuation, if you will. Well, in this continuation, what are we seeing? In the was, these things that played out over like 2,500 years. And then what would we have for a picture of that in the is? Well, in the big picture, you could say Rome, right? We had that with Constantine. So you could say it's that big picture with Rome, where Rome was there, Rome took over, Rome was destroyed, and then Rome comes back again. What else can you say? Well, what about Germany? In Germany, you had World War I, all because of Germany, right? Trying to take over the world. And then they were gone for a little bit. And what do people call World War II? Essentially the end of the story of World War I. And it was who again? Germany. You're seeing these pictures play out all throughout history. So what are we seeing? Babylon is there during seals, where it might end up being destroyed, but then coming back with a vengeance, and I shouldn't even say destroyed, but their leaders and some of the system destroyed, only for what? Only for mid-trumpets to come, right? Or mid-trumpets to come. And when the beast comes back again, Babylon is still there. Babylon is brought back. So you had one Babylon, the next one brings it back. You had Rome, and then Rome comes back. You had Germany, and then Germany comes back. So all of these things that played out over centuries and so forth, what do we know? In the end of days, will play out over 50 days and 14 years. But look at what we see about Babylon. Who are the leaders of Babylon? Nebuchadnezzar, Belshazzar, Cyrus, and Darius. They were all kings of Babylon. There's your 50 days. There's your portion during seals. And when Darius comes, who is a prophetic timing as the end of seals to go into trumpets, he was king over Babylon too. So as we track this, I don't want, like I said at the beginning, I'm not looking to go down that trail of what or where is Babylon for sure. But what we're seeing is that Babylon is there from the beginning, and even though there's a change in leadership along the way, and then it's diminished and vastly destroyed, it would seem Babylon is still there, which would lead to make sense that Babylon is destroyed when it's all over. Are you ready? When it's all over at the end of 70 years. I love it. Yes, it all started with 70, but it will all end with 70. Because what happens when this 70 is over in this typology? It's like the 70 had been playing out, and the Jews' captivity and all of these things playing out. Not being able to rebuild, but getting to rebuild the foundation and then being allowed to rebuild the temple. You see? And what happens at the end? Well, doesn't Babylon have to be destroyed at the end? At some point, mystery Babylon itself, the city, has to be destroyed. So look what happens. In Jeremiah chapter 25 that we've been sharing on recently. In Jeremiah chapter 5, we got the 70 years of captivity that we've been talking about, right? That Jeremiah spoke unto the people of Judah and to all the inhabitants in the 13th year. Very interesting, right? And then what do we see? With Nebuchadnezzar, right? So remember how I said it's this twofold 70 and this starting and this ending of 70. But it still ties into Nebuchadnezzar and Babylon, like a starting of it and an ending of it. And what do we know happens at the end of these 70? Well, listen to this. Jeremiah 25, verse 11. And this whole land shall be a desolation and an astonishment. And these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years. You see, 70 years. So was it just that they've been serving Babylon, you know, if it's the UN or whatever, for these 70 years? And since Jerusalem has been back? Or is it the other 70 from when they had all of Jerusalem? Well, when we look at the wording here in Jeremiah, it's hard to picture it as this one when we see what the wording is that says after 70 years. Because when the 70 years of this 70, of when they had both sides or all of Jerusalem, it leaves us 1 year in the prophetic is to come, the 14th year, which is the day of the Lord when he's returned feet down and destroys the enemies of Jerusalem. So what does it say? And it shall come to pass, Jeremiah 25, 12, and it shall come to pass when 70 years are accomplished that I will punish the king of Babylon and that nation. I will punish Babylon and that nation. Babylon, right? Saith the Lord, for their iniquity and the land of the Chaldeans, and I will make it perpetual desolations. Is Babylon perpetual desolations from the beginning of tribulation? No. Babylon is the reigning place. So then this has to be a picture of this other end of 70 years. And it says, and I will bring upon that land all my words which I have pronounced against it, even all that is written in this book which Jeremiah hath prophesied against all the nations. Against all the nations. You see, going back to 2 Chronicles 36, when we follow the story as the same 70 years, but having come to an end, there was no devastation. Why didn't it go in to describe the destruction of 70 years now coming against Babylon? That Babylon would now be perpetual desolation. This is what I was saying earlier. The prophetic laying out of the scripture and the way it's worded and the way one event follows to the next is purposely prophetically written. We've shown many of these types of things within the Gospels. You'll remember, I'll get back to this in a second. It's just like a little squirrel moment. You see, when you go to Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and you go to Luke, and you go to the triumphal entry. It's a prophetic picture of Luke of the beginning of the 40 days of the Son of Man. The in Mark, it's the him coming at the end of 6 years of seals. In Matthew, it's him coming feet down on the Mount of Olives. And what do you see in Mark? In Luke's story that follows the triumphal entry? It's only in Luke's. The way it follows is the story here that is not found in Mark or in Matthew. When he weeps over Jerusalem, telling them they're about to be compassed about, surrounded and destroyed, because they knew not the day of their visitation. What's he telling them? It's a picture of the Lord who has come for 40 days in the years to come, who's telling them that they're about to be compassed about and destroyed, just like Luke chapter 21's discourse. It's in this order, prophetically spirit-led by the writers for a reason. That is exactly what I'm talking about in this case and in many cases as well. The purpose of it being laid out the way it is and not having this destruction and being not only the king of Babylon, but also Babylon being a desolation. Why isn't it spoken of here? Because in this story layout, it's now going to the time of Cyrus. It's now going to the end of the 70 and the 14 years beginning. But when we go to Jeremiah and we see it in chapter 25, we're seeing this perpetual desolation that's about to come upon Babylon itself. Do you see how it couldn't be in 2 Chronicles 36 when it goes into Cyrus? Because what did Ezra tell us about Cyrus? He was a king of Babylon too. And what was Darius? He was a king of Babylon too. So we've got Babylon still surviving till the end of tribulation, with different kings and different heads throughout. Until what? Well, if Darius is the type that allows the rebuilding, and then the beast is coming back, who was, is not, and then shall be when he comes out of the pit, then what's he taking over? Probably Babylon, right? He would be the one everybody's turning to. He's going to declare himself God. He's going to make war against the Yeshua Messiah, right? Against the Messiah ben Joseph and Messiah ben David, right? The Zerubbabel. Because he was the one rebuilding Messiah, right? Joshua, Yeshua is the high priest and king. War is going to be broken out against them. So you've got who's back? You got the leader of Babylon back, right? The king of Babylon is back. The beast is back. And so the woman, which is the city itself, must still be there. So you're getting this purposeful layout from one revealing this going into this, and then from the other showing what's going to come at the end of the 70 years, which is the final destruction of the city of Babylon at the end of 70, probably right at the beginning of the 14th year. So in Jeremiah, this is what we're seeing. And it says this whole land shall be a desolation and an astonishment, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70. Okay, wait. And it shall come to pass after 70 years. Yeah, that Babylon and that nation, Babylon, will be perpetual desolations. Okay. And it will also be, as Jeremiah prophesied, against all nations. Which means this must be the time of Revelation 19, as we've shared on this before, which is the wrath of Almighty God. Which is what? The cup of the wrath of the Lord of God. You see how it intertwined? How just in this picture alone, you cannot assess this picture and put it to the end of 70 years when all of Babylon is going to be destroyed and be a perpetual desolation when Babylon is still going to be here during seals. The Daniel picture makes it impossible. But yet the Daniel story shows us that there must then be another 70. And lo and behold, only this year do we have a 70 ending. And only after 13 more years do we have a 70 ending. And it's when the Lord returns feet down to destroy them in what? In the wrath of the cup of the wine of Almighty God. So what does he have them do at the end of 7 years? They've all got to drink of the cup of the wrath, right? And made all nations to drink. The mingled people, all of it. They've all got to drink. Make them all drink. Make them all drink. And what does it say? Because of the sword which I will send among you. And then in verse 29, for lo, I begin to bring evil on the city which is called by my name. And should you be utterly unpunished, you shall not be unpunished. For I will call for a sword upon all the inhabitants of the earth, saith the Lord of hosts. Therefore prophesy against them all these words, and say unto them, the Lord shall roar from on high, and utter his voice from his holy habitation. He shall mightily roar upon his habitation. He shall give a shout as they that tread the grapes against all the inhabitants of the earth. A noise shall come even to the ends of the earth, for the Lord had a controversy with the nations. He will plead with all flesh. He will give them that are wicked to the sword, saith the Lord. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, behold, evil shall go forth from nation to nation. Did you hear that? Thus saith the Lord of hosts, behold, evil shall go forth from nation to nation, and a great whirlwind shall rise up from the coasts of the earth, and the slain of the Lord shall be at that day from one end of the earth even unto the end of the earth. They shall not be gathered, nor burned, nor lamented. Do you know what this is, right? How is evil? The Lord's going to allow evil to go from nation to nation. It is the treading of the grapes of wrath of Almighty God. The slain will be dead from one end of the earth unto the other. Well, clearly, that means they're gathered to the wrath of God, which is the treading of the winepress, which is the seventh year of trumpet judgments, the 14th year of tribulation, when the 70 years of Jerusalem are done. But what did it say? It said that evil would go from nation to nation. Well, the Lord's not evil. The Lord's not the evil one going from nation to nation to destroy them. So who is the evil one? How is evil going from nation to nation? Well, that's because the bowls of wrath bring about the destruction of what first? Babylon. Babylon is destroyed first, with the bowls being poured out on Babylon. See, the great river Euphrates is dried up, that the kings of the east might be prepared. It's got to be Middle Eastern for Babylon. In Revelation 16, 13, listen to this. And it says, and I saw three unclean spirits like frogs. Okay. These are the evil spirits. Like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon, the beast, and the prophet. Which means it can't be the sword of Revelation 19 that begins it. The bulls come before the seventh trumpet sword, right? The Revelation 19 sword of the wine of the wrath of God, of the wine press of the wrath of God. Because what happens in the wine of the wrath press of God is the beast and the false prophet are cast alive into the lake of fire, and then Satan is bound. Here, they're still here, which means the bowls get poured out before the second sword, which is the Revelation 19 sword. And what does it say? Remember, evil goes out, it said, into nations, right? Evil goes out from nation to nation. Listen to what it says. Revelation 16, 14. And for they are spirits of devils. Remember evil? goes out to nation to nation, working miracles which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world, going from nation to nation, to gather them to the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Which means these bowls happened before the great day of God Almighty, which is the treading of the grapes. Which means Jeremiah 25 is telling us that when the 70 years of the Jerusalem gathered, reunited, when that 70 years is done, which is this one, we have the final 14th year, which we have understood and known for a long time now. It will begin with the bowl judgments against Babylon, with its destruction to be a perpetual desolation, with the bowl judgments poured out. And then, as we saw those spirits, those evil spirits, like frogs, that go out. Let's go back to that piece. Where is it? See, verse 29. For lo, I bring, I begin to bring evil upon the city which is called by my name. Shall come a noise from the end of the earth, the great world. Lord of hosts. Oh, verse 32. Thus saith the Lord of hosts: behold, evil shall go forth from nation to nation, to bring them to what? To the great slaughter of the treading of the grapes of the wrath of Almighty God, when they will be from one end of the earth to the other. They will neither be gathered nor buried, because it'll be the final destruction, the final battle of Revelation chapter 19. The treading of the winepress of God. Brothers and sisters, I hope that blesses you. I hope, you know, definitely take your time, study it out, seek it, search it. We can see this just tracking this now. We were able to do something here tonight that we hadn't seen or understood before, from connecting the Nebuchadnezzar first dream to understanding the imagery of the tree and him being cut down is the picture of the time of the head now being gone, having then the stump and the roots, which is Babylon, still there, and having Belshazzar take over as a picture of the beginning of seals, but also having Cyrus there at the same time. Both of them showing their first year in places that we have known prophetically reveal the beginning of tribulation. Both of them in showing the third year in events that we know are taking place in the third year. To then show why Darius comes at the end of the prophetic type, at the end of the sixth year of seals, where now Belshazzar's time is over, and Cyrus's time is over, because now Darius takes over, and you've got the seventh year of seals, and then the first year of trumpets, which would be Darius's second year, when he allows the rebuilding, and they will then start to rebuild the city and the streets and the temple. Which is why, as we bring this to an end and we go to Daniel chapter 9, we see the commandment of Cyrus, for which in these 7 weeks as years of seals, they never got to rebuild the street and the wall and the temple again. It got confounded that they weren't able to do it. And the only thing that got built in these first 7 weeks as years were the foundations, or was the foundation of the temple. And it won't be till after those 7 weeks are done that you have then the next about 3.5 years, which is Zechariah chapter 8, the first year of trumpets beginning, into the 3.5 years, which is the 11th year, when the street shall be built again and the wall, and as we know, the temple. And when those about 3.5 years in that 11th year, when it's over, who is here? Messiah. And in the typology, it was a Darius. But we know Messiah, the Messiah ben Judah, Messiah ben Joseph was here. Zerubbabel was here because Zerubbabel is now the one who is completing and doing this rebuilding. He was the overseer while Messiah was the high priest and king until he's cut off. How does he get cut off? Because the beast that was and then is not during the first half of trumpets is going to come when the pit is open. When the pit is open, Messiah is cut off and war breaks out against them for 2.5 years. It starts by the dragon when he's cast down. He goes after them with a flood. The pit is opened and war takes place against Messiah ben Joseph and Messiah ben David, right? The two of the trumpet portions. And war breaks out against them after the rebuilding, after the 144 had gone out. What happens at this cutoff? You're at mid-trumpets, the 11th year of tribulation. And we're now what? Laodicea starts again. It's the end of days, Laodicean age. And it's the war with the enemy there for 2.5 years, all three of them, the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. And how long do they get? 2.5 years until what? That final 1 week as 1 year. 1 week as year. 2.5 years, which is why Daniel 12, exactly what it says, time times and a half, not time and times and a half. 2.5 years, one, that's 3.5. About 3.5 years, that's 7 years. And this 7 right here. 7, 3.5, 2.5, 1. What is this one? Exactly what we just ended with. When the Lord returns, destroys Babylon, pours out the bowls upon Babylon, and they gather themselves together to come and fight in the great treading of the grapes. We can now show, did you catch it? We can now show that the bowls happen before the final sword. Pretty wild, right? Brothers and sisters, again and again, you know, take your time, go through it. We can track this now. You can see who's here, what their time is, how long they're here, what their portion is. Be able to prove it by their year count, the events taking place in those things of that year count of their reign, exactly as we'd revealed in Scripture. It's exciting, guys. I pray it blesses you. I pray it strengthens you. I pray it gives you more to dig into and really sink into, ask questions, pray over it. Man, it's always, always so exciting. I love spending this time, guys. I love teaching it. I love digging into it. And I look forward to the next one. If not the next one, then the one after, but maybe even the next one, we can do a Zephaniah teaching. But it may be the one after. We'll see how all this plays out because there's just so much that we're digging into now, so much that people are sharing and finding and spending the time seeking and searching in. So with that, brothers and sisters, I love you always. God bless you. God bless your families. We'll talk to you soon. Bye for now.